Danish West Indies. The Danish West Indies, or Danish Antilles, was a Danish colony in the Caribbean, consisting of the islands of St. Thomas with, St. John with, and St. Croix with. The Danish West India Guinea Company annexed the uninhabited island of St. Thomas in 1672 and St. John in 1675. In 1733, St. Croix was purchased from the French West India Company. When the Danish company went bankrupt in 1755, the King of Denmark-Norway assumed direct control of the three islands. Britain occupied the Danish West Indies in 1801-02 and 1807-15, during the Napoleonic Wars. Danish colonizers in the West Indies aimed to exploit the profitable triangular trade, involving the export of firearms and other manufactured goods to Africa in exchange for slaves who were then transported to the Caribbean to work the sugar plantations. The final stage of the triangle involved the export of cargoes of sugar and rum to Denmark. The economy of the Danish West Indies depended on slavery. After a rebellion, slavery was officially abolished in 1848, leading to the near economic collapse of the plantations. In 1852, the Danish Parliament first debated the sale of the increasingly unprofitable colony. Denmark tried several times to sell or exchange the Danish West Indies in the late 19th and early 20th centuries, to the United States and to the German Empire respectively. The islands were eventually sold for $25 million to the United States, which took over the administration on March 31, 1917, renaming the islands the United States Virgin Islands. Merchants in Copenhagen asked King Christian IV for permission to establish a West Indian trading company in 1622. But by the time an eight-year monopoly in trade with the West Indies, Virginia, Brazil, and Guinea was granted on January 25, 1625, the failure of the Danish East India and Iceland companies and the beginning of Danish involvement in the Thirty Years' War dried up any interest in the idea. Prince Frederick organized a trading mission to Barbados in 1647 under Gabriel Gomez and the de Caceres brothers, but it and a 1651 expedition of two ships were unsuccessful. It was not until Eric Smith's private 1652 expedition aboard the Fortuna was successful that interest in the West Indies trade grew into an interest in the creation of a new Danish colony. Smith's 1653 expedition and a separate expedition of five ships were quite successful, but Smith's third found his two vessels captured for a loss of 32,000 rigsdaler. In August 2 years later, a Danish flotilla was destroyed by a hurricane. Smith returned from his fourth expedition in 1663 and formally proposed the settlement of St. Thomas to the king in April 1665. After only 3 weeks' deliberation, the scheme was approved and Smith was named governor. Settlers departed aboard the Eendracht on 1 July, but the expedition was ill-starred. The ship hit two large storms and suffered from fire before reaching a destination, and then it was raided by English privateers prosecuting the Second Anglo-Dutch War. Smith died of illness, and a second band of privateers stole the ship and used it to trade with neighboring islands. Following a hurricane and a renewed outbreak of disease, the colony collapsed, with the English departing for the nearby French colony on Sainte-Croix, the Danes fleeing to St. Christopher, and the Dutch assisting their countrymen on Ter Thalen and stealing everything off value, particularly the remaining Danish guns and ammunition. The Danes formed a board of trade in 1668 and secured a commercial treaty with Britain, providing for the unmolested settlement of uninhabited islands, in July 1670. The Danish West India Company was organized in December and formally chartered by King Christian V the next year on March 11, 1671. Jørgen Iversen Dyppel, a successful trader on St. Christopher, was made governor and the king provided convicts from his jails and two vessels for the establishment of the colony, the yacht Den Forgyldte Krone and the frigate Faroe. Den Forgyldte Krone was ordered to run ahead and wait but ended up returning to Denmark after the Faroe under Captain Zacharias Hansen Bang was delayed for repairs in Bergen. The Faroe completed her mission alone, establishing a settlement on St. Thomas on May 25, 1672. From an original contingent of 192 officials, 116 company employees, indentured servants, and 62 felons and former prostitutes, only 104 remained, 9 having escaped and 77 having died in transit. Another 75 died within the first year, leaving only 29 to carry on the colony. In 1675, Iversen claimed St. John and placed two men there. In 1684, Governor Esmond granted it to two English merchants from Barbados, but their men were chased off the island by two British sloops sent by Governor Stapleton of the British Leeward Islands. Further instructions in 1688 to establish a settlement in St. John seem not to have been acted on until Governor Brettell made an official establishment on March 25, 1718. The islands quickly became a base for pirates attacking ships in the vicinity and also for the Brandenburg African Company. Governor Lawrence raised enormous taxes upon them and seized warehouses and cargoes of tobacco, sugar, and slaves in 1689, only to have his actions repudiated by the authorities in Copenhagen. His hasty action to seize Crab Island prohibited the Brandenburgers from establishing their own Caribbean colony, however. Possession of the island was subsequently disputed with the Scottish in 1698 and fully lost to the Spanish in 1811. St. Croix was purchased from the French West Indies Company in 1733. In 1754, the islands were sold to the Danish king, Frederick V of Denmark, becoming Royal Danish colonies. The first British invasion and occupation of the Danish West Indies occurred during the French Revolutionary Wars when at the end of March 1801 a British fleet arrived at St. Thomas. The Danes accepted the Articles of Capitulation the British proposed and the British occupied the islands without a shot being fired. The British occupation lasted until April 1802, when the British returned the islands to Denmark. The second British invasion of the Danish West Indies took place during the Napoleonic Wars in December 1807 when the British fleet captured St. Thomas on 22 December and St. Croix on 25 December. The Danes did not resist and the invasion was bloodless. This British occupation of the Danish West Indies lasted until November 20, 1815, when Britain returned the islands to Denmark. By the 1850s, the Danish West Indies had a total population of about 41,000 people. The government of the islands were under a governor-general, whose jurisdiction extended to the other Danish colonies of the group. However, because the islands formerly belonged to Great Britain, the inhabitants were English in customs and in language. The islands of that period consisted of. On January 17, 1917, according to the Treaty of the Danish West Indies, the Danish government sold the islands to the United States for $25 million, in current prices. When the United States and Denmark exchanged their respective treaty ratifications, Danish administration ended on March 31, 1917, when the United States took formal possession of the territory and renamed it the United States Virgin Islands. The United States had been interested in the islands since at least the 1860s. The United States finally acted in 1917 because of the island's strategic position near the approach to the Panama Canal and because of a fear that Germany might seize them to use as U-boat bases during World War I. St. Thomas was a hub of the West Indies packet service from 1851 to 1885. Denmark issued stamps for the Danish West Indies from 1856 onward. The Danish West Indies were inhabited by many different cultures, and each had its own traditions and religions. The king and the church worked closely together to maintain law and order, the church was responsible for people's moral upbringing, and the king led the civil order. There was no state-sponsored religion in Denmark until 1849, but in the Danish West Indies there had always been a great deal of religious freedom. Danish authorities tended to be lenient towards religious beliefs, but required that all citizens had to observe Danish holidays. Freedom of religion was partially granted to help settle the islands, as there was a shortage of willing settlers from Europe. This worked to an extent, seeing that a large proportion of settlers were in fact Dutch and British natives fleeing religious persecution. Jews began settling the colony in 1655, and by 1796 the first synagogue was inaugurated. In its heyday in the mid-19th century, the Jewish community made up half of the white population. One of the earliest colonial governors, Gabriel Milan, was a Sephardic Jew. In spite of a general tolerance for religion, many African religions were not recognized because they typically revolved around belief in animism and magic, beliefs which were consistently met with scorn, and were regarded as immoral and subservient. A widespread viewpoint was that if you could convert slaves to Christianity, they could have a better life, and therefore many slaves were converted. By 1900, with a population of 30,000, a fourth of the people were Roman Catholics, along with Anglicans, and some Moravians and other Protestant groups. For decades the Moravians had organized missions and also taken charge of the educational system. Laws and regulations in the Danish West Indies were based on Denmark's laws, but the local government was allowed to adapt them to match local conditions. For example, things like animals, land, and buildings were regulated according to Danish law, but Danish law did not regulate slavery. Slaves were treated as common property, and therefore did not necessitate specific laws. In 1733, differentiation between slaves and other property was implied by a regulation that stated that slaves had their own will and thus could behave inappropriately or be disobedient. The regulation also stated that the authorities were to punish slaves for participating in illegal activity, but many owners punished slaves in their own. There was a general consensus that if the slaves were punished too hard or were malnourished, the slaves would start to rebel. This was borne out by the 1733 slave insurrection on St. John, where many plantation owners and their families were killed by the Aquamu, including Brefu, before it was suppressed later the following year. In 1755, Frederick V of Denmark issued more new regulations, in which slaves were guaranteed the right not to be separated from their children and the right to medical support during periods of illness or old age. However, the colonial government had the ability to amend laws and regulations according to local conditions, and thus the regulations were never enacted in the colony, on grounds that it was more disadvantageous than advantageous. By 1778, it was estimated that the Danes were bringing about 3,000 Africans to the Danish West Indies yearly for enslavement. These transports continued until the end of 1802, when a law by Crown Prince Regent Frederick that banned the trade of slaves came into effect. When Denmark abolished slavery in 1848, many plantation owners wanted full reimbursement on the grounds that their assets were damaged by the loss of slaves, and by the fact that they would have to pay for labor in the future. The Danish government paid $50 for every slave the plantation owner had owned, and recognized that the slaves' release had caused a financial loss for the owners. However, the lives of the former slaves changed very little. Most were simply hired at the plantations where they had previously worked and were offered one-year contracts, a small hut, a little land and some money as part of a sharecropping system. However, as employees, former slaves were not the plantation owner's responsibility and did not receive food or care from their employers. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.